This is considered by many to be the finest example remaining of a mid-19th century ornamented steam engine. But the question is, why would they have built it that way in the first place? I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution. So first, let's talk about the stuff we know. We know that it's a single cylinder, dual acting cylinder, 36-inch bore, 72-inch stroke. It produced about 250 horsepower at 32 RPM. Without the ornamentation, this would be a fairly standard sort of steam engine. Came down to this large flywheel. The shaft here, which is now cut, originally extended out, had a gear on it when it was purchased, connected up to equipment in order to run a factory. Very standard steam engine, except for the Gothic styling. So how did it get here? Let's talk about that. So there's at least two versions of the story. First version is that this engine was built in 1836 by I.P. Morris Town and Company in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Following that story, and according to a previous owner, this was originally built as a marine steam engine to operate on a steamship. They based that, based on the original valves. The original valve gear had four double-beat balanced poppet valves, which are typical of marine engines at the time. Looking at this engine, however, in its current form, this doesn't look like a marine steam engine. According to reports, the museum doubts this version of the story and questions if it would have been a marine engine. And in its current form, I question that as well. The second version of the story is that it was probably built in 1855 by Novelty Ironworks, and then later rebuilt by them in 1867. Now, there's no explanation of why it would have needed to be rebuilt after only 12 years. Although, since this doesn't look like a marine engine, the museum does think this is probably the most accurate version of the story, according to reports I was able to find. So eventually we come into known history, and we know that in 1857, this was installed at Tatum Brothers Leadworks in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. And they appear to have bought it used. It provided mechanical power. And that power was used to produce lead pipe and sheeting in their Philadelphia works. This was originally built as a right-hand steam engine, but when it moved to Tatum, they switched the crank and the flywheel over to the other side. When it moved to the museum here, the crank and flywheel were moved back to the original side where you see it today. You do see down in the main body, however, where there's easily room that you can move the crank and flywheel to either side depending on your needs. So a rebuild did occur by Novelty Ironworks in 1867, and that appears to have included changing out valve gear, among other things. One thing that didn't change is that the engine does not use a standard parallel motion at the top. Instead, as you see here, you have the piston rod connecting up to a horizontal bar. That bar follows along on two rails, and those rails then are used to connect the two oddly shaped pieces above it to the main overhead beam. This was done instead of the standard parallel motion, but basically served the same purpose, to allow the piston rod to continue simple vertical motion while accounting for the arc that you get from the overhead beam. The other end is a standard crank used to convert the motion from that overhead beam down to the flywheel. Speaking of the flywheel, although this is the way it was originally produced, in operation at some point at the Leadworks, they actually connected a piece of sheet metal around the rim and used that for a power takeoff. This is basically the same thing you do if you have a bicycle generator and it takes power off of your wheel. That was not reinstalled when it was moved here to the museum. It was not part of the original system either. Also, you see the large cut here in the center of the large flywheel. The rim is in pieces, but the central hub was originally cast as one piece. That had to be cut when it was transported here to the museum. And that cut was left intact. The separate rim pieces, as you can see, were cast individually and bolted together, but the hub originally was a single piece. So why would you spend all the extra money to do all this extra iron work to make this engine, well, honestly, quite beautiful? And, well, there's number of answers for that, I suppose. Sometimes these were put out like right out in front where everyone could see them. And they were a demonstration of your company. And Henry Ford did that. If you look at his village industry sites, he used hydroelectric power extensively at these sites. And all the hydroelectric equipment was right out front in this huge glass enclosed rooms where everyone going by could see it. That wasn't the case with this one, though. This engine, by all reports, was actually tucked away in the back of a factory where no one would see it except the people working there. So was it done to make the people happy that worked there, to think, you know, that there's some beauty in my workplace? Was it done because the salesman of this engine was basically selling to the CEO and not the people who had to maintain it, and knew that, you know, if he had the better looking engine, the CEO was going to be more likely to buy it? That's quite possibly the case. Or maybe to impress customers, as we still see happening even fairly recently. In the IT world, for example, up through the 90s, it was pretty common that your big server rooms would always have these huge glass walls on one wall to show off all the computers inside. And anytime you brought a company through, and you had a potential client come through to show it off, you'd walk them by, you'd stop, you'd show off how high-tech you were, how great your computer equipment was, and that would be used as a selling point. And maybe that's the reason that this engine was built like this. In any case, we do know that the engine was built like this, and there was a trend to do that for a while. When this was moved to the museum, most of this ornate work was retained. A few changes happened. The wheel was moved back to the original side, as I mentioned. The sheet metal band around was also removed. And one additional thing was done. So maybe you saw these stairs and you wondered, what are those for? Because they just seem to go up to the top of the fulcrum and go nowhere. But take a little closer look, and you'll see there are actually a number of holes in the casting here. Not only at the top of the fulcrum, but all the way around this rail at the top. Originally, there was an upper platform that went around the top of the engine. We don't know why it was there, and I wasn't able to find any photos, but that upper platform likely would have continued with the same Gothic design, allowed access to the top of the steam engine, and possibly to an upper floor or something. Again, we just really don't know. So this engine remained in use until 1929, when John T. Lewis and company, Tatum's successor, donated it to the Henry Ford Museum. They were able to move it here, and today this represents the ornate features that were added to many steam engines at this time. And that's why this is the Industrial Revolution.
Before you go, I do need your help. There's two things you can do. Number one is help YouTube get more people to the channel. Easiest way you can do that, completely free, hit like on the video, subscribe to the channel, and best of all, you can comment more than just two or three words. That tells YouTube, you know, this video is good, the channel's good, send more people here. Second thing you can do, each of these videos ends up being pretty expensive to actually produce. Obviously it's hours of work for each one, but I also have to actually drive to the locations. And if it's far enough away, I have to spend a night in order to do all the on-location filming that I do for these videos, that I think is essential for the videos. If you can help out financially, either with a super thanks, or if you can help out over at patreon.com/industrialrevolution, that'll help me to extend my range even further, get out to more and better sites, and bring you even better videos. Thanks for watching. Look forward to seeing you next time.